Intramuscular epinephrine is the first-line treatment for anaphylaxis, and additional doses may be required for refractory symptoms. Patients with anaphylaxis to Hymenoptera stings should be referred to an allergist for venom immunotherapy. Endotracheal intubation and mechanical ventilation are indicated in patients with severe asthma unresponsive to maximal medical therapy and who have signs of impending respiratory arrest. Signs of respiratory failure include altered mental status, minimal aeration, hypercarbia, and worsening hypoxemia. Transfusion-associated circulatory overload can occur when a large volume of blood product is rapidly transfused, particularly in children aged less than 3 with chronic anemia. Signs include respiratory distress, hypertension, tachycardia, and pulmonary edema within 6 hours of transfusion initiation. Management includes diuresis with furosemide. Bronchopulmonary dysplasia, a chronic lung disease of the neonate, which causes a persistent oxygen requirement and is commonly seen in premature infants, especially in those requiring prolonged mechanical ventilation or oxygen supplementation. Parapneumonic effusions occur after bacterial pneumonias, lead to pleural inflammation and exudation of fluid into the pleural space. Small effusions in children without respiratory distress can be managed with oral antibiotics and close outpatient follow-up, while moderate or large effusions require drainage. Staph aureus is the most common cause of bacterial pneumonia in young children with cystic fibrosis, especially in those with coexisting influenza infection. For patients with severe pneumonia, frequent hospitalization or recurrent skin infections, intravenous vancomycin should be included for empiric therapy against methicillin-resistant S. aureus. Not all patients with cystic fibrosis are identified through newborn screening because screening doesn't detect less common CFTR mutations, and therefore the presence of nasal polyps, recurrent sinopulmonary infections, digital clubbing, and signs of pancreatic insufficiency like poor growth, deficiency of fat-soluble vitamins should prompt an evaluation. The first step in the management of a newborn with suspected congenital diaphragmatic hernia is endotracheal intubation. A gastric tube should also be placed immediately to decompress the stomach and bowel. Bag and mask ventilation can exacerbate respiratory decline and should be avoided. Congenital diaphragmatic hernia results in herniation of abdominal contents into the thoracic cavity. Patients have respiratory distress at birth with absent breath sounds on the affected side, a barrel-shaped chest, and a scaphoid abdomen. Chest X-ray shows intrathoracic bowel loops and a displaced cardiac silhouette. Drowning is defined as respiratory impairment after submersion in liquid. Aspirated liquid causes hypoxemia and can wash out pulmonary surfactant, leading to insidious onset of ARDS. Patients who are asymptomatic after non-fatal drowning should undergo prolonged, greater than 8 hours of observation due to the risk of delayed pulmonary complications. Hypoxic ischemic brain injury due to drowning can lead to widespread neuronal cell death, cerebral edema, and increased ICP. Severely increased ICP can cause Cushing triad, characterized by hypertension, bradycardia, and irregular respirations. Epiglottitis presents with acute onset of respiratory distress, means stridor, plus dysphagia and drooling, and also tripod positioning, which includes sitting, leaning forward, and hyperextending neck. The first line management is endotracheal intubation. The patient should be kept calm and aggravating interventions like detailed oropharyngeal examination should be minimized because agitation may cause laryngospasm. Sudden onset of respiratory distress with unilateral hyperinflation and mediastinal shift on X-ray are concerning for foreign body aspiration. Rigid bronchoscopy is the first line because it can identify and remove the aspirated object. Foreign body aspiration should also be considered in a patient with persistent cough or wheezing following a choking episode. However, X-ray findings also may be normal, and bronchoscopy is indicated if clinical suspicion remains high. A croup, a viral infection that causes subglottic edema and narrowing, presents with barky cough and inspiratory stridor. Patients with stridor at rest are treated with corticosteroids and nebulized epinephrine. A large thymic silhouette is a normal finding on frontal chest X-ray in children aged less than 3 years due to its relatively large size and cell sign due to its triangular shape. Necrotizing enterocolitis would be suspected in an enterally fed, premature or very low birth weight infant with non-specific apnea, lethargy and abdominal distension. Pneumatosis intestinalis on abdominal X-ray is diagnostic. Histologic findings of bronchopulmonary dysplasia include decreased number and septation of alveoli. Respiratory distress syndrome classically presents in preterm infants with grunting, flaring, retractions, and cyanosis immediately after birth. Chest X-ray shows diffuse ground glass opacities and air bronchograms. Obstructive sleep apnea presents with disturbed sleep with loud snoring, daytime fatigue because of episodic upper airway obstruction due to adenotonsillar hypertrophy in young children. OSA can present with parasomnias and aneurysis. Mechanism of aneurysis may be related to the elevated levels of B-type natriuretic peptide. Cardiovascular consequences of OSA can include systemic hypertension, tachycardia, and structural heart changes like right or left ventricular hypertrophy and also pulmonary hypertension. In OSA, open mouth breathing and gasping for air may be there, but in contrast to adults, children with OSA may not demonstrate daytime sleepiness. Daytime symptoms in children may manifest as inattention, learning difficulties, and behavioral problems. In adults, OSA is often associated with obesity, but in young children, OSA associated with failure to thrive, low percentile for weight. An empyema occurs after bacterial pneumonia, leads to bacterial colonization of pleural fluid. Pleural fluid shows a pH less than 7.2, low glucose level, neutrophil predominant leukocyte count greater than 50,000 per millimeter cube, and significantly elevated lactate dehydrogenase level. Chylothorax is an exudative effusion due to disruption of lymphatic flow within the thoracic duct. Mostly it's because of cardiothoracic surgery. Pleural fluid analysis demonstrates milky white fluid with elevated triglycerides. Other etiologies of chylothorax includes Down syndrome, Noonan syndrome, and malignancy. The risk of pneumothorax is increased in premature neonates, particularly those with respiratory distress syndrome who are receiving mechanical ventilation. Transillumination reveals increased brightness on the affected side. Hemodynamic instability or signs of tension pneumothorax like mediastinal shift warrant emergency needle thoracostomy. Spontaneous pneumomediastinum, SPM. Severe coughing paroxysms can increase intraalveolar pressure and cause air to leak into subcutaneous tissues, and that leads to subcutaneous emphysema. Presentation often involves acute chest pain, and on examination, subcutaneous emphysema is typically palpated in the neck or precordial areas. A crunching sound may be heard over the precordium. It is also called Hammann sign. In rare cases, spontaneous pneumothorax can accompany SPM, and because of that, the first step in the management of SPM is chest X-ray to confirm the diagnosis and rule out pneumothorax. Respiratory distress syndrome, RDS. RDS incidence is inversely proportional to gestational age. The most important risk factor for RDS is prematurity, and others are male sex, perinatal asphyxia, maternal diabetes, and cesarean section without labor. In case of maternal diabetes, maternal hyperglycemia causes fetal hyperglycemia, which in turn triggers fetal hyperinsulinism, and high levels of insulin antagonize cortisol and block the maturation of sphingomyelin, a vital component of surfactant. Treatment of RDS consists of antenatal corticosteroids and postnatal exogenous surfactant. Bronchiolitis, a winter respiratory tract infection, which is caused by respiratory syncytial virus and manifests as upper respiratory symptoms, wheezing, crackles, and respiratory distress. Wheezing, crackles, and respiratory distress can have a waxing and waning course that peaks on days 5 to 7 of illness. In older children, RSV infection is generally self-limiting, mild upper respiratory tract infection, like nasal congestion and rhinorrhea. While in children aged less than 2 years, tend to have lower respiratory tract involvement, and infants aged less than 2 months are at high risk of developing apnea and respiratory failure from bronchiolitis. And also they tend to develop recurrent wheezing throughout childhood. And it's because of that, palivizumab is a monoclonal antibody against RSV used for prophylaxis in children aged less than 2 years. Symptoms of bronchiolitis typically begin with cough and nasal congestion and peak on day 3 to 5 of illness with worsening cough and increased work of breathing like tachypnea and retractions. Hypoxia is common. Chest X-ray finding may include increased interstitial markings and peribronchial coughing, hyperinflation and atelectasis, and also absence of focal consolidation is typical. Most patients can be treated as outpatients with close follow-up. Transient tachypnea of the newborn, a condition caused by delayed resorption and clearance of the pulmonary fluid. This resorption is driven by increased catecholamine signals in the late gestation and markedly increases during labor, and therefore patients born prematurely or by cesarean delivery are at increased risk of TTN. Presentation of TTN includes respiratory distress like tachypnea, grunting and retraction, and hypoxia in the first few hours after delivery. Breath sounds are often clear in patients with TTN because most of the fluid is in the interstitial space rather than in the alveoli. Chest X-ray includes hyperinflation, fluid in the interlobar fissures. I have completed pulmonary and critical care subject in pediatrics. Thanks for listening. You cannot believe in God until you believe in yourself. Stay awesome.